Orgmar. Next, I would like to call upon Mr. Rudra Pratap Singh Chauhan, convener, president, and founder member of Freshovich Krishak Club, an NGO which has more than 1,500 active members together, who organize farming of vegetables and horticulture crops. He has over 14 years of experience in the agriculture field. I hope this this session is really invigorating. And now I hand over to you, Mr. Paul and Mr. Anil.
All of us here, firstly, thank you very much for your interest in being here. Paul and I will co-moderate this, but it's these practitioners who are actually in the business of financing, operating, and have done and achieved a lot themselves that we really want to learn from going forward. We really wanted to focus on three areas just to open up the discussions. One is clearly the regulatory and the infrastructure aspect. The second is the capacity building, skills development side of these enterprises. And thirdly, of course, the financing and the investment side. Between Paul and I, we'll sort of ask you to opine on this. But starting off, maybe I can request Mr. Rudra Pratap Singh to give you an overview and talk about the first aspects, both in terms of the infrastructure and the regulatory aspects.
To start with, the infrastructure would be that's a very big word in terms of agri. But let me start coming in with a very small statement. Basically, the whole agri sector in this country can be divided into two parts. One is the irrigated part and the non-irrigated part. Typically, why we're looking at an investment in agri today is the whole of the irrigated belt today. As an individual farmer, wherever your land, even if I take a land cost at a level of say 3.5 lakh rupees an acre, the return on that with the capital investment on a normal farming of wheat, rice, lentils, at today's price levels, get a return of 8%. Now, if this is without intervention regarding marketing, or without an intervention in terms of technological dissemination, in terms of feed, just imagine, the potential has come in over there in terms of being a business model. It's not anymore that it's a way of livelihood for a farmer. The challenges specifically is in terms of aggregation in terms of land, aggregation in terms of the produce, and of course the infrastructure to aggregate them. These are the areas where we look in. These challenges are basically on the investment part. So there's a reason why we look at this as an opportunity for a business. Looking in again at the regulatory part, yes, there are concerns in this part in terms of the government interventions which are there, which has not been relieved, but then there are ways within the regulatory framework that you can form
the so company. Rudra, just to channelize the discussion on the regulation issue, can I request you to focus on two pieces? One is, what do you think about producer companies and those legal entities in the context of investable producer models? My understanding is that producer companies really don't lend themselves to investments. So that piece, I'm sure others can contribute, and I'm sure Hemendra would have his own thoughts around that. The other piece is around the APMC Act, the whole aspect of agriculture produce marketing. And who does it really benefit now? Is it producers or entire chain of middlemen in the group? So if you could reflect on that a little bit, that would be useful.
Okay, the first one, I'll come to the APMC first. Typically, there's a lot of pressure in most of the states where the APMCs have now started relaxing. So as an individual, as an entity, whenever you look at any state, entering a state, nearly around 17 states are such where now as an entity where you can enter as a centralized license, which actually facilitates most of the companies coming in and doing a cross-border, across state trade. So that is already on the way. And in the 12th plan, the central government has a lot of focus, and the funding of the state governments is also dependent if they have the APMC Act amended. So that's another that we, that was one. The second, when we talk about the entities, whether it is a farmer producer company or we talk about multi-state cooperatives, yes, there is a cap in terms of the private equity players coming in and placing and then moving out, because that's the basic theme which they have is a socialistic theme over there when they have formed this. But definitely there are ways where you can look at private limited companies, where you can look at JVs, where you have the societies working parallelly in a SPV with the JV where we can work it out. These models are already existing, so only thing is these are informal contracts, now they can become into a formal part of it.
Before we come down to financing, you clearly have done small business financing over the years in many parts of the world. And when you were starting up this seed fund many years ago with IFC, and that's a capacity building, and now it's good to see that you're doing this internationally. But from seed's point of view, what are the kind of financing instruments that you can provide? What are the issues that you look at when financing this business, and what are the risks that you see which are peculiar to this business, and how really it will get to, or any other thoughts you have on this?
Thank you, Mr. Sinha. From SIP's perspective, we see tremendous opportunity in the whole food supply chain in India, and that's the reason we have started a 100% sector dedicated fund on food and agribusiness, clearly focused on small and mid-sized business enterprises. The whole food value chain, we divide in about 30 odd sectors, but clearly we are much more bullish on the upstream of the food supply chain than downstream. This is one area which is, as most of you would know, is relatively unaddressed because the deals are not in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore. They are in places where most investors don't have management bandwidth to go or don't have the size of investment which suits their investment criteria. So I believe that, on the upstream side, in particular, if you talk about producer organization, we do believe there's a huge potential in India. Just to give you some idea on the size of opportunity, we believe there is, you would know that size of a food and agribusiness sector in India is about $250 billion. We believe that it's going to go to $500 billion in the next 10 years. And if you look at what proportion of this is getting sold to, let's say, organized retail or organized format, as of now it's about $2 to $2.5 billion, and we believe this can go to as much as $40 to $50 billion in 10 years' time. Now, world over, no retailer gets into the supply chain part. They do have their quality control, they do have their vendor selection mechanism, etc. But nobody's into manufacturing, nobody's into aggregation. Even if they are, they typically are getting out of it, like some Walmart or Carrefour, Metro. They typically source from aggregators or producer organizations where the size typically is billions of dollars. Now we see that opportunity emerging in next 10 years in India also. So that's one part of it. Secondly, the kind of interest we have seen from foreign multinationals to be in India, like Sof, Cargill, ADM, Bunge, Olam, all of them want to have a very substantial presence in the country. Again, the biggest hitch is I can't go to millions of farmers to source my volumes. So there has to be a link which connects me to the farmer, which is reliable, which can give me the requisite quality and quantity of raw material on time. And that is preventing a lot of these so-called multinationals to have a larger presence. Even on food processing, we are seeing likes of Okla Food, likes of Barry Kolhapur, who want to have presence in India. So either they are looking for a partner who can do it for it, or they link up with aggregators. Third part, as Paul mentioned, is on APMC. With change in APMC Act, I think there's an opportunity for aggregators to link directly with retailers and processing companies. So no questions on the size of opportunity and the growth prospects. When it comes to investment, we have evaluated a few models. There are some fundamental issues which we are facing, and I won't say I have the answers today, but yes, I'm sure with some kind of structuring, these models can become investable. one big challenge is typically right now the model that we are typically sourcing and selling, which clearly leads to very thin margins, which are trading margins with a net profitability of let's say 1-3%, which is tough for an investor to really sort of look at from the investment perspective. You have to have a model which clearly indicates that even if it's 2%, it has to go to 6% in the investment period. So our suggestion to the entrepreneur is always that can you bring in the value-add component? That could be in many forms. You have storage, you have your cold chain, you have your primary processing. I think those components are probably missing, and we are happy to look at our investments going into that, which can improve that margin. That's number one. Second, scalability, which is very key. And when I was there in jury yesterday, I was very happy to see that most entrepreneurs confess that if they have a, let's say, vegetable selling model in Lucknow or in Patna, they can't go to Chennai and do it themselves. So what does it mean? You need multiple partnerships, you know, across different geographical locations who can do it for you. And then all these entrepreneurs have to come under one company to make it really scalable. So these are some of the
Sure. So from agri business, I think it's good to shift to dairy business before we come back to you, Bjorn. But you know what, one thing, Mr. Rao, that surprises me is actually two parts to this question. One part is the northeast of India and the east of India, fundamentally, doesn't seem to have, organized dairy doesn't seem to have picked up. And therefore, investable models, I think, are limited there. I was surprised to hear that in Odisha there are just two private companies now being set up. What does that indicate? I mean, you are in Andhra Pradesh, so what does that indicate for investable dairies in the east of India?
Thank you. First of all, I am very comfortable talking about dairy compared to any other subject. Yeah. As far as the Andhra experience goes, the first requirement for successful dairy farming is the farmer's mentality and the farming ability and aptitude, which is very much there in southern part of India, where that's why we could successfully start the dairying and we are successfully able to scale up the operations of the dairy farming. But as we have seen in northeastern areas, one, a territorial imbalance because of very elevated ranges and farming practice itself very limited over there. There not much of farming activity goes on there except yielding crops like tea and coffee and other things. So in fact, we find it's a good consuming center for us than a production center in northeast, because the farmer's aptitude is not towards farming. The population aptitude not towards farming. And geographical location also is not very much suitable for the farming, because of growing fodder is not a practice over there. Whereas in Andhra, when I see earlier years, agriculture used to be a primary activity. But slowly, with not so remunerative prices or some other produce, but with continuously milk price going up, people like us coming to the business, and from the farmer side and paying better remunerative prices to the farmer. Dairying is becoming a major agricultural activity in not only Andhra but many other activities, primarily because of remunerative prices being paid to the farmers. Here